much new to report on. Just invite you to look over the bulletin and be in prayer for those names that are there as prayer requests, and be in prayer for them. That includes our missionaries as well. Turn in your Bibles to the book of Ephesians again in chapter 1. Just kind of launch pad. Ephesians chapter 1, and we'll read again verse 13. Whom ye also trusted, after that ye heard the word of truth, the gospel of your salvation, and whom also, after that ye believed, ye were sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Looking at the doctrine or the teaching of the gospel, the first point that we have been considering is, what is the gospel? What is the gospel? Brother Mike was talking about those hard sayings, those hard words of Christ, and the multitudes left when he looked at his 12 and said, "Will ye also go away?" And a light clicked on, brother. I've referred to that. I've preached on that passage many, many times. I have a message I preached several years ago. Will ye also go away from that text? But we've commented from time to time, and you'll hear comments from time to time. Why is it? In fact, I think someone said it in the last couple weeks. Why is it the Armenian gets so upset when you preach God's choosing and salvation all 100% of God? What's a hard thing? The same as in John chapter 6 and Jesus expounding to them the gospel, expounding to them things concerning himself. And he said, just before they went away, he said, it is the Spirit that quickeneth.
Yes. Amen.
You see, it's not a man. It's the Spirit of God that quickeneth. So the Armenians get mad and upset over the truth of the gospel. You see, because they don't believe it. That's not saying that they're all not saved, because I believe there are some saved Armenians. They just haven't come to the truth,
right, amen,
of God's word, and they go away from us, or they'll drive us out of their strongholds, so to speak. Mm-hmm. But in considering what is the gospel, we looked at 1 Corinthians chapter 15, verses 1 through 4, and discussed the fact that the gospel was how that Christ died according to the scriptures. He was buried according to the scriptures. They rose again according to the scriptures. Tonight we want to approach it from the standpoint that the gospel is the dunamis, the power of God unto salvation.
Amen.
Turn with me to the book of Romans, chapter 1, and verse 16. Romans chapter 1 and verse 16. We read here, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation To everyone that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. There's some people that object to you using a concordance and looking up the Greek or the Hebrew and giving forth English meaning. I don't have a problem with that. I think it's good to help us to understand the passage. Basically, because our English language has evolved. It has dumbed down. And so it helps us in looking at what the actual English words were then, and even using a dictionary. I like using Webster's 1828 dictionary, and getting back about as far as I can with the English words. I want to use that in this verse. For I'm not ashamed of the gospel of Christ. I'm not ashamed of the gospel proceeding from Christ. For that is what of means. Proceeding from or out of or proceeding from. I'm not ashamed of the gospel proceeding from Christ. The good news proceeding from Christ. For it is the power, the dunamis, the word from which we derive the word dynamite from, or dynamics from. For it is the power proceeding from God unto salvation to every one that believeth, to the Jew first, and also to the Greek. So everyone that believes, they believe because of the power proceeding from God in the gospel proceeding from Christ. Who is Christ? John 1:1. God. He's God. Verse 17. For therein, in what? The gospel proceeding from Christ. For therein is the righteousness of God, the righteousness proceeding from God. Keep that in your mind. Revealed. The gospel proceeding from Christ reveals the righteousness proceeding from God. From faith to faith, as it is written, the just shall live by faith, and that by faith. Let's see if we can put this together. Verse 16 and 17 together says that the gospel is preached when it's preached under the power proceeding from God. It reveals to us the righteousness which proceeds from God.
Yes.
What does that do? That shows us our need of salvation. Because the only thing that you and I know as man is our righteousness, which is not or righteousness at all.
Amen.
Which is revealed when we see the righteousness which proceeds from God through the preaching of the gospel which proceeds from Christ. In other words, in Christ Jesus, we see the righteousness of God as it is revealed to us. And that is under the power of God, not under your own power.
Amen.
It has to be under the power of God. Think about all the times that you heard the gospel preached. Were you saved every time you heard a priest? No, what was absent? The power of God. The power of the Holy Spirit of God. Turn with me back to the 16th chapter. In verse 25. Now, to him that is of power to establish you according to my gospel. What was Paul's gospel? We just read it in Romans 1:16. The gospel of Christ. The gospel which proceeds from Christ.
Amen.
My gospel and the preaching of Jesus Christ. He clarifies it there. He says, the gospel which I preach, which is Jesus Christ.
Amen.
According to the revelations of the mystery, which was kept secret since the world began. We won't go into all that mystery. God, this word here for power is not, let me get my spot here. This word for power here is not dunamis. This goes to God is of ability. God is of ability to establish what? To establish his people.
Amen.
To not only establish them as his people, but to make them stable in the gospel. Now, to him that is of power, to him that is of ability, to establish you and to make you stable in the gospel. It is by his ability, it is by his power, not man's ability and power. And he uses the gospel of Jesus Christ, the gospel proceeding from Christ. Well, I can't help it. Which was a mystery from since the beginning of the world. In other words, Christ hadn't come. Now Christ has come.
Amen.
Yes, I think we discussed this before. Yes, the Israelites, and should have been able to see it in the ceremonial law and in the moral law. They should have been able to see Christ there. And yes, some did see Christ.
Yes.
But by and large, it was a mystery to them. And not only was it a mystery to many in Israel, but it was a mystery to the rest of the world.
Yes.
They had not the ceremonial law. They had not the moral law. All they had was the heavens, the firm creation of God, which declared the glory proceeding from God, the glory of God. Turn with me to 1 Corinthians chapter 9. In verse 18. Well, I want to back up here. Paul had, in this ninth chapter, had addressed an issue with the Corinthians concerning them that live of the gospel, live to preach the gospel. They are committed, as he calls it, the dispensation of the gospel was committed unto them. In other words, it is entrusted to their care. It is their duty to declare the gospel of God, that they should live of the gospel. In other words, the church should be responsible to see to it that they're taken care of. He comes down here to verse 16. For though I preach the gospel, I have nothing to glory of. For necessity is laid upon me. Yea, woe is unto me if I preach not the gospel. He states here that it's his duty. God committed it to him as he does to every God-called man.
Amen.
The responsibility to preach this book.
Amen.
Look at verse 17. For if I do this thing willingly, I have a reward. That word reward is dues paid for work. In other words, Paul's saying here, if I take this thing upon myself and go preach the gospel, then I have a right to charge for the preaching them. But, he says, but if against my will a dispensation of the gospel is committed unto me, but if it's against his, in other words, it was put upon him. God put it upon him.
Yes.
He didn't have a choice in the matter.
Yeah.
As every God-called man, he doesn't have a choice in the matter. Or he would say, well, yeah, he can choose whether he's going to obey God or not. Yeah, to that point, to that extent. But God places it upon him. And I tell you, there's a burning in the heart to do it, isn't there, brother?
Amen.
Read Jeremiah.
Yeah.
He said, thy words were a burning. He had to go. He wasn't going to go. He didn't want to go. He didn't want anything to do with it. But he couldn't help it. Had to go. Look at verse 18. Because it is placed upon him, he didn't take it up willingly. He says in verse 18, what is my reward then? What is my wage? What is the dues paid for work? preach the gospel, I may make the gospel of Christ without charge, that I abuse not my power in the gospel. He said, to charge for that which God has placed upon me, it's my duty to do, it's my responsibility to do, it's my service as a servant of the Lord to do, to charge for that would be wrong. He would abuse his power in the gospel, his authority in the gospel. Should a church take care of their pastor? Yes, a church should take care of their pastor. We do not have men come in that charge for their services of preaching the gospel. We don't pay. To me, they're not a God called man. They're, as Paul said, took it up willingly. That's something they wanted to do. It's an occupation. Mm-hmm. With that. Should the church take care of those preachers who come in and stand in the pulpit and preach a sermon or two sermons or a week of meetings? Yes, the church should take care of them, but it's without charge. They don't charge for that. They're just doing their duty. They're doing their responsibility. I've never turned down an operation. Well, I had to once. Twice. Well, maybe a couple of times. Because of work. Because, you know, I was asked to preach at fellowship. I said, I got to work. I can't get off. I can't take off work to go to the fellowship meeting, so I can't come and preach. Don't like to turn down an opportunity to preach. God's placed that responsibility upon me. But he said there's a power in the gospel, there's authority that he's been given to declare the gospel message, and it's the same one whose power with the gospel brings men to salvation. That power, that authority comes from God. You see, to preach the gospel. Turn with me to 1 Thessalonians. 1 Thessalonians. Chapter 1. In verse 5, for our gospel, there again, whose gospel? Our gospel. What's our gospel? Well, it better be the gospel of Jesus Christ. It better be the gospel which proceeds from Christ, proceeding from Christ. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, many times. I'm an example. Maybe others are examples of the gospel coming in word only. That's all those times it was preached to me. But I went away just as lost as I was when I went in. And you too. It came in word only. But he says, now to these that are saved, to these Thessalonians, and to anyone else that is saved, it came not only in word only, but also in power, in dunamis, and in the Holy Spirit, and in much assurance, as ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sake. And I wrote at the end of that verse, Romans 1:16. For I'm not ashamed of the power of the gospel of Jesus Christ, for it is the power of God unto salvation to everyone that believeth, to the Jew first and also to the Greek. That word Greek is synonymous with Gentile, yes, yes. Anyone who is not a Jew. Amen. So you Jews, Paul said in Romans, he said, you Jews, it's not to you only, but it's to the Gentile also, anyone who believes. Yes. But he's writing many Jews in that church at Rome, and he wanted them to know that it was not just them only, but the Gentiles who believed also. Now, I want to do the same thing with this verse. With a little word, two-letter word. In. In. The Greek word for it is in, by, or with. In, by, or with. Use in, use by, use with. Doesn't change the meaning a bit. So let's look at this. For our gospel came not unto you in word only, but also with power. And by the Holy Spirit. And with much assurance. As ye know what manner of men we were among you for your sakes. You see? Helped in the understanding, didn't change the meaning a bit. You see, because that is exactly what happened. It came with power. The power of God, Paul referenced in the first chapter of Romans, in verse 16. And it came by the Holy Spirit. It came by God. It was the power of God. Just as Jesus said in John chapter 6. It is the Spirit that quickeneth. The Spirit that makes alive. And we'll be saying more on that next week. On some thoughts that we have. Turn with me now to 2 Timothy. 2 Timothy. Chapter 1. And verse 8. Be not thou therefore ashamed of the testimony of our Lord, nor of me, his prisoner, but be thou partakers of the affliction of the gospel according to the power of God. According to the power of God. Be partakers of the afflictions of the gospel according to the power of God. Partakers of the affliction. That is, suffer hardship together. In other words, be as one. In the suffering of the hardship. Under what circumstances? Under the circumstances of the gospel. Particularly the preaching of the gospel and the living of the gospel. You preach the gospel and your life lives the gospel, you're going to suffer for it. You're going to suffer hardship. What kind of hardship? You want to know what kind of hardship? Keep your finger there. Turn with me back to 2 Corinthians chapter 11. verse 21. 2 Corinthians chapter 11, verse 21. I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, whereinsoever any is bold, I speak foolishly, I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. In labors more abundant, in stripes above measure, in prisons more frequent, in death oft, of the Jews 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. Thrice was I beaten with rods, once I was stoned, thrice I suffered shipwreck, a night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils by mine own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and nakedness, beside those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Wow!
Yeah. Wow.
And Paul said here to Timothy, he said, suffer together in the gospel. Suffer hardship together in the gospel. Preacher, why would we want to do that? Maybe that's a problem. See, Paul wrote that, and we got many, many church members who are scared to death. Not witness. And he said, besides that, the care of the churches. You don't think there's some hardship attending to a church of the Lord Jesus Christ? Yes, there's some hardship to the flesh. Now he said that these sufferings, hardships, together, is of the gospel, according to the power of God, which is only sufficient to enable us to bear them. It is only His power that whereby we are saved. It is only His power whereby others are saved. And it's only His power by which we're enabled to bear those hardships that Paul's talking about for the gospel. You and I can't do it in and of ourselves. But it's under the power of God. We can. I can do all things through Christ. Strengtheneth me. 1 Corinthians. We'll close with this one. 1 Corinthians chapter 1 and verse 18. For the preaching of the cross is to them that perish foolishness. But unto us which are saved, it is the power of God. It is the dunamis proceeding from God. For it is written, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, and will bring to nothing the understanding of the prudent. Where is the wise? Where is the scribe? Where is the disputer of this world? Hath not God made foolish the wisdom of this world? For after that in the wisdom of God, the world by wisdom knew not God. It pleased God by the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. I want to do the same thing again with this verse. The word end. For after that end. End by with. For after that, with the wisdom of God, or by the wisdom of God, the world, by the world through, that is the English word, in or the Greek word is through it, wisdom of God, the world through wisdom knew not God. It pleased God through the foolishness of preaching to save them that believe. See, it's through the foolishness of preaching. Actually, the word translated by is correct word, but it's through is up here, the first one, and by is way down here. But evidently in their day and time, they understood by equally as well as through. And we should too, but do we, you see, concerning this word. Now, verse 22, for the Jews require a sign, and the Greeks seek after wisdom. But we preach Christ crucified, unto the Jews a stumbling block, and unto the Greeks foolishness. But unto them which are called, both Jews and Greeks, Gentiles, Christ, the power of God, and the wisdom of God, because the foolishness of God is wiser than men, and the weakness of God is stronger than men. Did you know there was any weakness with God? You see, no, as we as men, there's not any weakness with God. For ye see your calling, brethren, how that not many wise men after the flesh, not many mighty, not many noble are called, but God, hath chosen the foolish things of the world to confound the wise, and God hath chosen the weak things of the world to confound the things which are mighty, and base things of the world, and things which are despised hath God chosen, yea, and things which are not, to bring to naught things that are, that no flesh should glory in his presence. You see, salvation is all 100% of God. So that he gets the glory. Because if it's not 100% of God, then the flesh went to work. And it sounds to me like he knew man pretty well, didn't he? He knew what sin had done to us. But of him are ye in Christ Jesus. Of him. Of whom? Of God. Are ye in Christ Jesus, who of God has made unto us wisdom and righteousness and sanctification and redemption. All right, we'll close there this week, and next week we'll look at the second part of this, and that is, there's no regeneration. There's no regeneration without the gospel, right?